And there's a lot of really good arguments that people have made that, in fact, what makes people so uniquely smart is directly tied to our strong social organization, our social instincts. And this comes out in kind of several different ways. So Robin Dunbar made the argument that the reason we needed big brains is that we had such complex social organizations that you need to have a larger brain to sort of negotiate and figure out, like, where am I in this social hierarchy and how should I outsmart, my other people so that I can get higher in the social hierarchy? And how can I negotiate these different kind of political dynamics of, how do we form these teams and work together and yet also scheme up against others? And so all these kinds of complex social interactions require a lot of intelligence, and that may have been an evolutionary force that drove the increasing size of our brains. Michael Tomasello has a slightly different perspective, emphasizing the fact that, relative to chimpanzees and gorillas, one of the most important differences in us is actually that we really care a lot more about cooperation and about sharing. And in particular, like, if you look at the interactions between like a mother and child in a chimpanzee relationship versus a human context, the human mother and child really have a lot more of this kind of interactive sharing dynamic between them, both sharing experiences, food, everything. You really don't see quite as much of that in our nearest kind of ape relatives. And so Tomasello argues that this real strong motivation and desire to share is what makes us kind of special. We've really kind of amplified that dimension, and that gives rise to all of culture, this sharing that we have of all of our thoughts and ideas, and that culture then lifts everybody up and makes us all that much more smart. And so I think that makes a lot of sense. And really, people again don't appreciate in that same kind of what is water kind of idea how important our culture is for everything that we think. We have this tendency to think of ourselves as kind of individuals, and we see our own subjective kind of individual perspective on the world, but we don't realize how much everything we do is just shaped by our kind of culture. And then Jeffrey Miller has this sort of yet another perspective, which is that a lot of what we do and that makes us smart is essentially showing off. And this is sort of the other side of sharing. You can share in a more pro-social way, but you can also share in a more like, hey, look how cool I am kind of way. And that this may have to do with sexual selection. So the famous example of the peacock's tail, this kind of crazy, weird, not very adaptive looking thing that kind of shows how, powerful and impressive this particular, bird is with this huge tail. And so, maybe a lot of our smarts, our intelligence is a way of showing how kind of fit we are. So all of these probably have some element of truth, but they all point again to how important the social organization is, and how important these social forces are for shaping who we are and how we behave. So fundamentally, as we've said in earlier chapters, motivation is what shapes learning, and what shapes motivation? Social forces. Social forces are the most important force shaping essentially learning, and therefore learning is what shapes how smart we are. It all fits together. So one of the things we can think about in terms of these social forces is how much of these, Maslow's hierarchy of needs is actually kind of uniquely human focused, right? So when we think about like self-actualization, esteem, love and belonging, those things really seem like uniquely human aspects of motivation. And that really gets at this same thing that Tomasello is talking about. That, a lot of what drives us is these higher level social kind of forces, and these basic kind of physiological and safety needs are more what's driving kind of, other apes and primates. But we go beyond and really have this stronger kind of higher level social identity and social esteem and kind of these higher level goals of figuring out our role in society These are forces that allow us to kind of go beyond those more basic low-level needs and really what drives our culture onward. But all these social forces have an impact, right? And again, we're surrounded by these forces, this water pressure kind of pushing in on us, this pervasive thing. And we really have our own subjective individual perspective, and we don't necessarily explicitly recognize, but we feel all these social forces, all these people kind of trying to tell us to do different things explicitly and implicitly, right? And so that creates this desire to rebel, to really emphasize how important the individual is. And this is something we'll see again that is very different in different cultures. So specifically in the US kind of very individualistic kind of focused culture, we end up with this kind of very strong desire to emphasize our individuality kind of in the face of this pervasive social pressure. And so these, the fascination with superheroes, for example, is really reflecting this kind of desire of the individual is great and the individual can still do amazing things, even though in fact, each of us is so dependent on our society. And we don't like that feeling, especially again here in the United States, of recognizing how strongly dependent we are on everybody else. And this goes back fundamentally to control, right? We absolutely want to be in control. This is the single most important driving motivational factor. We've talked about it so many times. And from our subjective experience, we have our thoughts, we have our plans. Those things seem to be the thing that drive what we do. So we subjectively see ourself as being, the source of all of our own individual control and motivation. And again, we don't have an easy way to see how much all of that is fundamentally shaped by our culture and all these outside forces. And so this tension, this battle between the individual, the self concept, and this kind of social world is really something that we see again in so many aspects of social psychology. And a lot of what people do in social contexts is try to establish the self-esteem and self-efficacy in the context of these larger social forces. And so, again, we're always being subject to these kinds of forces of ranking and dominance and popularity. And so we're always trying to establish where are we in that place. And so all these kinds of notions of social comparison dynamics that we'll talk about really play out in that context. So even when things aren't so much in control, we really try to preserve and enhance this sense of self-control and self-esteem and self-efficacy.